Good morning, everyone. It's great to see everyone here today. I'm very pleased today to welcome back Jamie Anderson Reed, who was with us back in August for two Sundays. Jamie is from the congregation in North Vancouver, St. Andrews and St. Stephen's, and she is on the board of managers there and the their visitation committee. She's been working on furthering her studies at Vancouver School of Theology and is going to be graduating in the spring with a diploma in denominational studies. So we're very pleased to have Jamie with us today again. Just got a couple of announcements to share with you this morning. First of all, our offering envelopes are out there in the narthex. If you haven't picked yours up yet, please do so. And our congregational meeting, annual meeting, is coming up on Sunday, February 27th, and it'll be after church. We still haven't got the decision on whether we'll have bringing your own food or whether we'll just have the meeting and I'll go home for lunch on our own. I'm not sure what we'll do, but we will be having the meeting here in the church, probably in Sloan Hall, after the service on the 27th of February. So keep that on your calendars, please. And I think that's everything for announcements. Just to please take a moment of silence as we prepare for worship.
Thank you, Gord. It's really nice to be back at Haney this morning. Thank you for welcoming me again so warmly. It was lovely to be here last summer, and it's almost summer outside again, so it's come early for us. I certainly think of Pastor Patty this week, and I'm sure our thoughts are with her today. It's lovely to be together in this space again, present with one another, but also if you are joining us online, you are welcome here. And let's come together with joy as we worship God this morning. We will start by lighting a candle. So if you are at home, I encourage you to light a candle in your own worship space. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." Let's stand together and sing verse 1 of Holy, Holy, Holy. Thank you. Be seated. Yes. You can follow along on in your bulletins this morning, and let's come together. Sing joyfully to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before him with joyful song. We are his people, the sheep of his flock. Know that the Lord is God. He made us. His we are. His people, the flock he tends. We are his people, the sheep of his flock. The Lord is good, and his kindness endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. We are his people, the sheep of his flock. Let's come together in prayer. Heavenly Father, gracious God, the sunshine you've sent us is so bright and so amazing. We only need to look out the window and see your handiwork and the hints of a spring soon upon us once again. Warmth, growth, new life, creation. We find ourselves astonished with the beauty and the design of what you've given us. We're in awe of your majesty and of your mystery. And we come before you humbly, oh, so humbly, Lord, for you are the source of all that is. Heavenly Father, you breathe out your word to us. You move within us, awaken us, and urge us to respond. Too often, Lord, we focus inward on ourselves, and we forget you. We forget to hear your words to us and to live by them, for we are so easily distracted by the earthly world around us. Forgive us, renew us, and remake us. Help us, Lord, work in our hearts, not only so that we return to you, but also so that we act on your words and your commandments to us, and focus on others as we show our love for you. We ask all this through the grace, mercy, and tenderness of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us as one family to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hear the assurance of pardon in Colossians 2 that states we are now alive together with Christ, achieved by his forgiveness of our sins through his death. He set aside sin and nailed it to the cross. Our sins, your sins, my sins, the sins of the world, the injustices of the world are nailed to that cross. Everything that breaks this world and breaks God's heart is nailed to that cross. But friends, believe the good news that in Christ we are forgiven and we are made alive. Thanks be to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let's stand together once more and sing How Great Thou Art.
I see.
Please be seated. I can tell from up here how much some of you really enjoy singing that song. Thank you. So we're going to have a little bit of story time now for the little kids in the room and online, and also the big kids in the room and online, too. So, Sue, if you would put our first slide up for me, please. So this is another Olympic year. I was here last time during the Summer Olympics, and this gymnast was competing at the Summer Olympics, and you can see her eyes are laser-focused on that bar. It's the only thing that matters in her world right now. But I appreciate that was the summer. This is the Winter Olympics. And this is our Canadian boy, Mikhail Kingsbury, who won a silver medal last week in the men's freestyle skiing. And if you look at his eyes, you can see he's laser focused on his task at hand too. And he's got a lot to think about as he goes down the hill. For those of you who don't like Olympic sports, a movie reference, this is Merida from the movie Brave. And again, you can see that fire in her eyes. She's a champion archer, never misses, and she can even do this from the back of a galloping horse. So the kid has some skills. We have to give her that. But for those of us from a different cinematic era, we'll have one more. And that's Robin Hood. And he had a lot of distractions, all right? He had his band of merry men, and I think there was something going on with Maid Marian, and then there was this really nasty sheriff. But he, too, he was very focused on what he needed to do. So how does this all apply to us, to be focused? Thank you, Sue. In our reading today, one of the big verses, this is called the Shema, and it says, "Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord alone. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength." And this is actually a prayer. And what it does is it helps to focus our hearts and focus our minds in love to God. And that's what we'll talk more about in our message this morning. Let's come together in prayer. Heavenly Father, focus our hearts, calm our hearts and minds in this moment, and help us to be present. Be with us here. Be with us in this place. Be with us online as we hear this. Help our hearts to be open to what you want us to hear in this moment, and allow your Holy Spirit to speak to us right here and right now. And let these words make personal, again, to each of us today, what was personal to the people listening to Moses all those years ago. For your great name's sake, amen. Susan, would you come read for us?
This reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 32, through to chapter 6, verse 19. So be careful to do what the Lord your God has commanded you. Do not turn aside to the right or to the left. Walk in obedience to all that the Lord your God has commanded you, so that you may live and prosper and prolong your days in the land that you will possess. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy a long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in the land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commands that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and your gates. When the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you, a land with large flourishing cities you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells you did not dig, and vineyards and olive groves you did not plant. Then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Fear the Lord your God, serve him only, and take your oaths in his name. Do not follow other gods, the gods of the peoples around you, for the Lord your God who is among you is a jealous God, and his anger will burn against you, and he will destroy you from the face of the land. Do not put the Lord your God to the test, as you did at Massah. Be sure to keep the commands of the Lord your God and the stipulations and decrees he has given you. Do what is right and good in the Lord's sight, so that it may go well with you and you may go in and take over the good land the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors, thrusting out all your enemies before you, as the Lord said. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Susan. So focus. All right, well, we could talk about anything. You can pick anything in life, and you need to focus on it, right? Game of checkers, a crying child, threading a needle, relationships, even the sports we talked about in story time. But it's more than just focus, isn't it? We need to be focused in love. There has to be love involved in everything that we do. Now, to help us understand how to be focused in love, we're going to talk about the context of our passage today. We're going to explore the things that distract us and steal our focus. And lastly, we will consider where or on who we should be focused as we move forward. And you might be asking yourself, well, what does love have to do with focus? And that's a fair question. I'm a firm believer of beginning with the end in mind. So what does any of it have to do with love? Who's got a Sunday school answer for me? Anyone? Yes? Oh, I can't hear you. Can you speak up? That's right. Absolutely. And Jesus, right? A couple of things there. That's excellent. Good job, sir. So Sunday school answer, perfect. Thank you very much. So to get some context, Deuteronomy is the longest sermon, all right? Because we're going to get to Jesus in a minute. So Deuteronomy is the longest sermon in the Bible and quite possibly the longest sermon ever given. It's also Moses' last sermon. And our reading today has us right in the thick of Moses preaching to his people. They're assembled on the plains of the Moab. This is the last stop on their 40-year journey from Egyptian slavery to promised land freedom. And Moses is making sure not to leave anything out. All right? We need to remember that these people assembled before him are not the ones who journeyed for 40 years. This is the next generation. So they don't understand all the hardship that their predecessors and forefathers went through. So Moses is taking this time to reiterate all the important pieces to them, the historical narrative and the Ten Commandments, and now we join them in the story. He tells them, chapter 5, verse 32 and 33, to be careful to do what the Lord has commanded you. Do not turn aside to the right or to the left. Walk in obedience to all that the Lord your God has commanded you, so that you may live and prosper and prolong your days in the land that you will possess. He's telling them that to live as people of God in the promised land of God, they need to live holy lives. Moses' words are vitally important. And he's giving his people all he's got because he knows what's at stake. He was with his people for those 40 years. He was there. He knows what's gone wrong in the past. And he's also not going to cross the Jordan. He's been precluded from that honor. He will not see the promised land. So Moses is using this opportunity to speak to his people one last time and stir their hearts to impress upon them the need to follow the commands, decrees, and laws that the Lord directed so that the people may enjoy long life. We too need to feel Moses' urgency and his enthusiasm for the people of Israel, because right now, that's us too. You know, as one example, we're not over the pandemic. We're not finished yet. We haven't crossed the Jordan. So as we think about that, I really want us to put ourselves in Israel's shoes. Moses is giving a lengthy sermon, right? So let's be honest. Are we focused on Moses' words? Are we rapt with attention as we read? Are the Israeli people focused on every word? Or do they just really want the milk and honey that comes after service when you go downstairs with coffee? We have to ask ourselves in our everyday life, is our focus really on God? Now where is our focus? Because it's easy to talk a good game about focusing on God because we know that's what we should do. But really, meaning it and living it in the deepest sense is a different matter altogether. So ask yourself, where's my focus? Now for interest, what does the Bible say about focus on God? We're in Deuteronomy, but that's just one book, so let's expand our thoughts for just one moment. Colossians chapter 3, verse 2 says, "Set your mind on things above, not earthly things." Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1 says, "Fix your thoughts on Jesus." Well, we could go on, and they're all pretty straightforward and simple in their instructions, but we know that as fallen people, it's not that simple. We get very easily distracted from the ultimate prize. So speaking of distractions, we know that today we live in a society of tremendous complexity, and we become goods at what we practice, and most of us are very good at practicing distraction. We live in a society that actually trains us to multitask and to jump from one thing to another uncontrollably. So how are we expected to focus? You know, for example, maybe we have children or grandchildren who are trying to figure out what to do with university, or they're in university, say, and they're trying to get good grades in courses, the courses that have been forced online by the pandemic. Maybe they're holding down a part-time job to help pay for tuition, trying to have a social life during a pandemic, maybe adulting for the first time if they're away at university. And on top of that, you know that their phone beeps every 5 seconds, right? We know it beeps all the time. That's a lot of things pulling for that young person's attention and their focus, and each of those distractions pulls away from where they're supposed to be focused. And what if we are in the next stage of life where we have bills to pay and a mortgage and a car payment, and maybe we're seeking job advancement, and that job is clearly one at which we multitask? And maybe we're also in the space of getting kids to different activities, all right, because you know they don't like the same thing. So one's doing art classes in Pitt Meadows, and the other is definitely playing basketball in Langley, and you know that they're at the same time on the same day. How do you focus? That's a lot of stuff going on. And what if we're older? And what if we're in a season of our lives where it seems that we lose a friend every week, and the Lord just calls them home? Or what if we live alone? What if our mobility just isn't what it used to be? Sometimes walking that few blocks to the grocery store, if you've got a walker, through an inch of snow on an icy sidewalk, It's not easy, right? And if you fall, the consequences can be great. Carrying that jug of milk is heavier than it used to be. The cost of that jug of milk has gone up too, but your pension hasn't. It's all hard, and it all steals your focus. Now, why am I giving you all these different examples? Well, here's why. Because we need to understand that life, as we live it, fallen as we are full of distractions from God and living the life He intended for us. Distractions prevent us from being in right relationship with God and with one another. And I say that because distractions, the distractions of our challenges and our circumstances and the life that is around us, turns us inward onto ourselves. It makes us focus on ourselves. Me. But hear this. If we all chose, and I mean consciously chose, to focus on those that we love, we would always have someone focused on us because we too are loved. And then we wouldn't have to focus on ourselves because someone's already doing that for us. Right? So hear that again. Focus on those that you love because those love you too. And then you don't have to worry about yourself. You don't have to focus on me. Instead, we love. But that's easier said than done. How are we supposed to do that? It is hard. But Moses gives us the answer. He says, as we learned in story time, chapter 6, verses 4 and 5, "Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord alone. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." This section of verses is called the Shema, and it became an important twice daily prayer in Judaism. It was meant to guide the vision and action of every moment of Jewish life, to focus life. So let's just break it down a little bit. So in Hebrew, the word listen or shema means much more than just hearing. In Hebrew, listening includes the hearing, understanding, and then responding in action. So in other words, in Hebrew, hearing and doing are essentially the same thing. We, in English, would call that obey. Love, in Hebrew, if we go to the second verse, is made up of the emotion of love and a conscious decision. And that conscious decision is the action part. So this is a wholehearted devotion to God that makes up your entire being, your heart, your mind, and your emotions. In the Bible, love is action. You can love someone when you act in loyalty and in faithfulness. And that's why the words love and listen are so tightly connected in our reading today. Another key idea in the Shema is the Lord alone. So after we're told to listen and right before we're told to love, the Shema says, "The Lord our God, the Lord alone." Now, in Hebrew, quite literally, the Lord alone is the Lord is one. So Israel is being reminded to worship only God. All right, so remember that they're about to cross the Jordan into the land of milk and honey, but that land of milk and honey is also Canaan. And in Canaan, the people worship all sorts of different gods, from war to sex and everything in between. So Israel is very unique in this time. It is the only nation that worships one God. So Moses is taking the time to tell them, do not follow other gods, the gods of the peoples around you. He is reminding his people to focus on the one true God in the midst of all the other imposters that are swirling around them. Now, here's a little bit of a New Testament tangent for you. The Shema was so widely practiced that Jesus himself grew up saying the prayer. And it was formative for him, and he used it in his teachings. And it was so formative, in fact, that when he was asked, which is the greatest commandment in the Torah? He answered, the first of all commandments is, listen, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. The second is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. And that's straight from the Gospel of Mark in chapter 12. That's right from Jesus. And that idea comes from the Shema. So hear it again. Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. It's beautiful, isn't it? But the crux here is that Moses knows the people of Israel will fail. We fail on a daily basis. But we have hope. The word love holds such a prominent place in this passage, and we are loved beyond belief, beyond our wildest dreams. Moses knows the journey is hard, and he is pouring himself out to the people of Israel for that very reason. In fact, part of the reason he's giving this sermon is because he knows exactly how hard it is. He's been there, and he knows there is something fundamentally hard about the Israelites' hearts, our hearts. Even though he is doing his absolute best to prepare them, he knows they will fail. We fail. But Moses is preaching a gospel that has redefined everything and everyone now in a participating relationship to a holy God, the one true God. And this is exciting. And there is energy in that, and Moses is blazing. All right, this man is 120 years old. And whatever age you are, hearing this, sitting here, watching online, think about that. At 120 years old, he is standing there with an entire nation standing before him, and he is just preaching his heart out. He's blazing. And just like the Israelites were instructed to worship the one true God by Moses and live out their unique relationship with their God, so are we. We also have that uniqueness of relationship. It is he who chose us, loves us, continues to forgive us, and renews his covenant with us. God gives us life. And the Israelites failed, and just like we do every day, we fall short. But God has a plan. Love came to us when we weren't looking for it. And as we receive this love, we receive Jesus. It generates gratitude, humility, and a commitment to honor and to love in return. And it's that love in action that the Bible tells us about. Love gives birth to more love, which results in faithfulness and obedience. And these are truths that can transform us from the inside out. I want to pose a question to us all as we prepare to go from here. What binds us together as family under Christ? What brings us to church every Sunday or to this YouTube recording every week? Is it habit? Is it obligation? Or is it the social interaction of a Sunday morning? What is it? Or, for all those reasons you can name, is it a shared vision of a future informed by the simple, eloquent commandment to love God and, in doing so, love one another? If we can trust in sharing that commitment, then we can go forward and do great things for the Lord and for each other. The kingdom of God does not advance with brass bands and bulldozers. but gently, hand in hand with one another and together, in right relationship with God and with one another. And that's what it means to be God's people. We're not going to be perfect at it. We're going to be far from it. But we are meant to try. And we are meant to live our lives focused in love to God and to one another. So who are you going to focus on this week? Remember that we are called to love, to hear and obey, and to be devoted to God with our very being. And in that, we are devoted to loving one another. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these words that Moses has given the people of Israel. And thank you for how they apply to us today. Thank you for continuing to show us your love. And thank you for sending your son Jesus for each one of us, Lord. Help us to understand how to love one another as we love you. Help us to take these words from Moses, Lord, and go live them in our everyday life. For your great name's sake, amen. Now we can stand and sing together. Blessed be your name.
Darkness closes in, Lord.
Please be seated. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your servant Moses, who used his life and his energy to convey your position to your people. We especially thank you for your continued forgiveness and for your grace that sent your son Jesus to us. Heavenly Father, we think of your world. We pray for the people affected by the trucker convoys and blockades, and we pray for safety for all involved and around, and for peaceful resolution. We pray for the authorities and leaders making decisions around these protests, and we ask for your wisdom and guidance that they may act in the best interests of the people and ultimately for your kingdom. Show them your way forward in love. Lord, we think of the Beijing Olympics, the Chinese people, the hosts, the organizers, the athletes, the coaches, the support staff, and the families. We pray for your blessing on all these people. We are encouraged by the gracious displays of camaraderie and sportsmanship. Those hearts show your love to others. But we also pray for your wisdom in addressing the publicized controversies, such as doping scandals, and your strength in addressing the silenced controversies surrounding human rights. God, we pray for the uncertainty in your world. We pray for the Ukrainian people who are living with the uncertainty surrounding a possible Russian invasion. Lord, many of us do not know what it is like to live under threat of war and attack, and we pray for empathetic understanding. We pray for your wisdom and your strength to move past a not-in-my-backyard mentality. And for those of us who do know what it is like to live under that threat, Lord, we pray for peaceful hearts, we pray for healing from trauma, and we pray for the wisdom to speak up and to speak out, and helping to inform others and working towards peace in your kingdom. And in all of this, Lord, around the world, far and near, right here at home, we pray for the ongoing pandemic. Lord, we are weary. We are still languishing. We pray for health and we pray for safety. We pray for awareness of our own actions and how they affect others. We pray for the frontline workers who are so tired, Lord. And we pray for the many minds of your creation continuing to work to combat the virus. Grant us wisdom, Lord. Grant us hearts that love and hearts that focus on others. Lord, we pray for Pastor Patty and think of her this week. And we ask that you are with her in the task at hand and grant her strength and peace in her actions. And we also pray for traveling mercies as she returns to us shortly. All of this we ask so boldly, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. And as we carry those prayers in our hearts and lift them to the Lord, let us stand together once again and sing Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Of rapture numbers.
rise from our worship this morning and go into the world as God's hand and feet, focused in love, blessing others as he has so greatly blessed us. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the presence of power of the Holy Spirit and the love of God go with us everywhere this day and always. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As we go in peace, let us stand and sing together, Be Thou My Vision.
Save that love.